This is the, to give it its full title, not another fucking NFT panel. So the aim of today is to really demystify and get under the hood of what it all means and actually send you away feeling a little bit clearer, perhaps better, certainly with a little bit more to think about in this area. So just to get started, has anyone bought an NFT? Anyone? Okay. Okay, so we're working like half the room. It's interesting numbers. Okay, cool. So I'm going to ask my panel just to give a quick introduction so we know where they're coming from in this world, and then we're going to get straight into a series of questions that I hope will unpack this, okay? So Chris, can I start with you?
Hello, everybody. Good morning. So my name's Chris Cooke. I'm the founder and managing director of a company called CMU. So I'm a journalist that writes about the music business, but we also do lots of research on trends in the business. So we have a partnership with an organization called Impala, which represents all the indie labels across Europe. And I am almost finished writing a report for the Impala membership all about NFTs and the metaverse and the opportunities for indie labels. So my brain is brimming with all of this stuff. I also talk a lot about rights, about copyrights and other sorts of intellectual property rights. The whole NFT world opens up so many copyright questions that don't get me going on that, otherwise I will bore you for several hours on it. But maybe we can talk a little bit about that as well.
Yeah, perfect. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Marlen Hüllbrock. I work for a company called Music Ally. We track and write about music marketing campaigns. We explore startups in the music space, new technologies, and then we write about that to provide insights to our clients. We develop training content, so we work together with management companies, with labels, and we train their teams in all things digital marketing, innovative marketing campaigns, new technologies, and we also work together with them actively on implementing some of these marketing activities.
Thank you. My name is Mike Walsh, and I work for a business called Serenade, and we're an eco-friendly music NFT platform, relatively new, only started trading in September, and we are all about demystifying and simplifying NFTs, so I think I'm on the right panel, which is great. I'm also an artist manager. I work for a couple of charities, War Child and Earth Percent. And yeah, looking forward to this panel.
I'm Jenn Morgan. I'm from a company called Cirkay. Cirkay is a Web3 D2C content solutions company. So what we've just done is released a FanPass NFT, which enables fans to access exclusive content through an NFT.
And my name is Charlene. I am a talent development manager in Belfast. I run my own artist management company, and my position today will be to ask questions, and I have lots of them because I represent a lot of artists who don't really understand the space but really want to, because we're hearing a lot about it now. And it doesn't feel like it's a thing that's ever going to go away. So let's understand it and then decide whether it's right for you in terms of embracing it. So let's go. I'm going to bat a few questions, and I'll let any of you decide to select them. So we'll start off at the very start. NFT, what does it stand for?
Non-fungible token.
Okay.
Fungibility is obviously a weird word, but the general concept is if something is fungible, you can exchange it for something else, and you still have the same value at the end of that. So £1 coin, you exchange it for another £1 coin, you've still got £1. You can use it in all the same ways that you've done before. If something is non-fungible, for example, if I borrow your car and I come back and I bring you back a car that's the exact same make and model, but it's not your car, that is something that is non-fungible. So it's not your car anymore. Okay. So it's getting that idea that something that is unique and has provenance.
Okay.
And I guess the reason why we're having non-fungible in the word, NFTs are built on this thing called a blockchain. Blockchain is best known for powering cryptocurrencies. And I guess that's the distinction we're making, isn't it? That if I have a Bitcoin and you have a Bitcoin and we exchange our Bitcoins, we've both got a Bitcoin. Whereas if I have an NFT, which is, I don't know, a Snoop Dogg track, and you have an NFT, which is a Kings of Leon video, and we exchange, we end the day with something different. So I guess the reason why we're honing in on the non-fungibility is to distinguish between this use of the blockchain and the cryptocurrencies that is the best known manifestation of that technology.
Okay. And in terms of the name, so the NFT name itself, Mike, you and I had a small exchange on that. Is there a better way to perhaps, you know, name it or describe it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think so. So I'm kind of getting a bit bored of the NFT acronym myself. So it's a little bit no fucking thanks for me, and I work in it. And I think that's just because it's got a little bit tardy, in the sense that I don't think us as a sector have found the black t-shirt yet. We've not found that thing that sells itself, that flies off the shelf, that really makes sense to audiences and fans. And I think there's lots of kind of noise and baggage we carry into the space from the past kind of 18 months, where you have really high profile projects that have gone incredibly well, but are for a very small subset of people. So it's, you know, crypto whales who are moving their currency around in order to avoid a tax event. And, you know, that's what has been the headline in people like RAC and Blau and Steve Aoki having these massive commercial outcomes. But for the average music fan, that's a little bit like, well, that's not me, right? That's happening over there, and why would I engage in this space? So I think we've all got a bit of a responsibility, and I know, you know, some good work happening with FanPass, some good work happening with other platforms like ourselves that are really trying to put the utility and the product ahead of the technology, and then fans can almost enter the space by just getting some really cool shit from their favorite artist that has provenance, can maybe appreciate in value, gives them some utility, but don't even need to know that they're entering into a Web3 space. And I think sometimes we're all guilty of putting the technology before the good shit, and the good shit is just what fans want from their favorite artists. So we often talk about changing the terminology, and actually it's a shame Sam Taylor's not here, actually, Chris's colleague, because he said something last week at The Great Escape which I wanted to challenge him on today. He said, let's embrace the ape, and what he was referring to was the Bored Ape Yacht Club, which is probably one of the most successful NFT projects of all time, but it's really high end and nobody can afford them anymore unless you're Eminem, and it's just a big flex for celebrities on Twitter. So I would say, let's escape the fucking ape, and let's put the ape in a cupboard, forget about it, and let's crack on with some reasonably priced utility that all fans can engage with.
I think Mike was also touching on a very important point here, that I think a lot of people and artist teams that haven't explored the space yet fully, they might think that an NFT has to be this one very specific thing, for example, cool artwork, and they might not understand, okay, why would someone buy it for a lot of money? But actually an NFT can be lots of different things. And as you said as well, I think the music industry specifically is trying to find a way of making it work for our industry, where it's way more about, okay, you have an NFT, but what can be done afterwards, and how can you bring value to the fan, and how can you make it exciting for the fan base? How can you make something that truly works for the artists and not just have this one static thing? So yeah, it can be lots of different things. It doesn't have to be one digital artwork.
And with the report I mentioned that we're writing for Impala, a lot of the report is it's worth making a distinction between the product and the actual token. I mean, the token is just a little bit of data that sits on the blockchain that is then connected to something, usually something digital, although there are NFTs connected to physical releases. So it could just an asset that the NFT is linked to. But yes, in this report, which we're publishing next month, we say, okay, well, actually, you know, you've got digital collectibles, you've got physical collectibles of an NFT, you've got the fan club notion, you've got people doing ticketing where there's a souvenir element with an NFT for the ticketing, you've got the people who are doing fan funding where there's a royalty share for the people who put money in. And those are actually five very different products that just all happen to have an NFT as part of the proposition. And in the same way that Spotify, iTunes Store, Bandcamp, and Patreon are all using some similar technologies, but they're five fundamentally different products and services. And I think that's true. Just because it is NFT enabled doesn't mean all of those projects are the same thing. So I think, yeah, I would agree, it's worth thinking, okay, these are the different products and services that people are dabbling with. They all have an NFT as part of the proposition. Why do they have an NFT as part of the proposition is one question worth asking. But then of those products and services, which ones do we think are going to be here for the long haul? And that's where I don't know. I don't know if some of these, they all sound interesting, but some probably have more potential than others.
I just want to add one more thing as well. I think I read about one artist that was saying, what I found quite interesting, the power of the NFT as well is that, whereas when you have like physical art, for example, it's static, like you buy a painting and that's what you get. But with an NFT, it can always evolve. So a fan might have your NFT, and then you can continue to have that relationship with them and you know, airdrop something to them with the NFT or continue to deliver content to that person. And I think that's quite exciting and like a good way of thinking about the differences there as well.
Yeah, so it's a dynamic asset in a sense. But I still think that we're still dealing with the issue of people finding it potentially strange that they don't have something tangible. And I guess let's speak to that. Is this a new thing for music fans where, you know, you purchase something and you don't have something physically to hold? Or has that been happening already?
I think there's an element of generational acceptance to this as well. Mm. And I say this is probably the oldest person on the panel. But there will be a generation of teenagers in the very near future who will put more value on digital goods than they will physical goods. You see it in gaming. You know, a lot of people say, look at gaming first if you want to have a glimpse of the future. You know, look what's happening in Fortnite. Like, how much does Fortnite make, Chris, in terms of just...
A lot of money.
It's literally billions of pounds.
And crucially, most of the money is through the
digital merchandise,
the skins and all of the digital assets within.
Yeah, exactly. So you're like, the idea of owning something digitally. And also, I just heard a great story the other day, which is kind of a sidebar, but I just thought it was amazing. A friend of mine saw his daughter at preschool the other day go up to the glass window where there was a fly on the outside. And she went, so she's three. And she went up to the window and she tried to enlarge the fly.
Oh my God.
So to say that future generations will be digitally native in a way that we don't yet understand and will be as comfortable in the metaverse as they are in the real world is an understatement.
Yeah. Okay. Cool. I think something to add to that as well is that when we're buying things within these spaces at the moment, they tend to be locked to the platform that they're in. So you buy something within Roblox or whatever, it's stuck in Roblox. But the idea with NFTs is that there will be interoperability. At the moment, it's not quite there, but the progression will take us to a point where you will be able to have something in one place, take it to another, and it will follow you with your digital identity, essentially.
And I think that's a really important point. I mean, assuming the Metas and Googles of this world don't come in and screw all of this up, which they could do. But there's this idea that the metaverse is coming. There'll be all these virtual worlds that we occupy. And some people would say, actually, in a way, those virtual worlds, you know, Instagram, in a way, is a virtual world that we all occupy, just not in the sort of the virtual reality sense of the word. But we'll have all of these metaverses which you can go into. And if it works, the idea is your NFT collection is a little portfolio of assets that sits on the blockchain, and whichever metaverse you enter, you bring those digital assets with you. So I enter a new virtual world for the first time, I press a button, the virtual world talks to my NFT collection on the blockchain, and suddenly all the images and the videos and the artists and the colors and the brands that are me are surrounding me in that metaverse. And I think providing the owners of these metaverses don't make them closed walls and stop that from happening, suddenly digital collectibles starts to make more sense, doesn't it? Once it's not a few MPEGs and MP3s sitting on a server somewhere and it becomes your identity in a virtual world, I think then, I mean, I still don't know if it necessarily is for me, but I'm too old. But I can see that for a lot of people that's very attractive, and particularly the sort of younger consumers.
Okay, yeah, that's really interesting. And I guess in that, because a lot of artists are looking at and trying to understand the NFT world in a sustainability kind of frame for them. So when you look at that and what ultimately a lot of artists need is, you know, fan connection, but also the kind of sustainability element that draws from that is, you know, often financial. So how does NFT relate to cryptocurrency, if at all? And like, how will that picture, do you see, evolve? Anyone want to?
I mean, a big myth is that you need to have cryptocurrency to buy an NFT. You don't. You can buy them with fiat currency, you know, pounds, dollars, whatever. So that's one side of things where it's becoming a lot more accessible. Mm-hmm. There's still a lot of friction points within crypto in general where, you know, if you do want to have cryptocurrency, you've got to do one step, then convert, then go to another step, wait a bit of time. If you want to wait less time, put some more money in. There's a lot of kind of stages, but those friction points will be removed as we go on. You know, if we had to all use Facebook and go through 10 different steps, it wouldn't have happened. So it's just a case where it will need to develop at a pace where it's usable for the average person to be able to grow. But that will happen, I see it.
I mean, I know Mike can talk about platforms like Serenade or trying to make it a much simpler process, but I guess there was a big, last year when NFTs became front page news and there was those stupidly high priced NFT sales, that's where there was a connection to cryptocurrency, because most of those purchases were being made by people who 10 years ago or whenever, how long ago it was, bought Bitcoin, and then Bitcoin exploded and suddenly they had all this money which didn't really feel real, and then they were sort of then investing that in NFTs. So I think a lot of that bubble that we saw last year was because of the cryptocurrency connection. But I think, as Mike said at the start, for the average music fan, where actually I didn't even know if the tradability bit is that important, it's just wanting a connection to the artist through an NFT. And I think, yeah, the more and more it becomes disconnected from that world, and it's just a platform you go in and you spend whatever money you spend, the more people are going to embrace it.
Yeah, we kind of had a conversation at Cirkay. We thought, you know, the way that our user journey works, you wouldn't know that you were necessarily buying an NFT in the same way with Serenade. It's something you could potentially just not include in your marketing, but we felt that it was important that people knew what it was and that they got that educational point. But as things go down the line, we will be using this technology more and more where we just won't even think about the fact that it's an NFT. It will just be a click, and then it's there.
Cool. So let's anchor this now very centrally to an emergent artist or an artist who's just getting started off, who hasn't hit that critical mass point yet. How can an NFT be part of their ecosystem? And again, test cases here, feel free to throw any examples of anything that you see that's been experimented upon that's working. Because and it's a double barrel here, because the misconceptions that we've talked about, the Bored Ape stuff, the, you know, the flexing of the, you know, the very wealthy muscle on this has created a lot of misconceptions where perhaps independent artists who are just building their following and building essentially that fan trust aspect, which is key, I believe, in all of this, are looking at potentially at NFTs and thinking, that might not be for me. So let's talk about how emerging artists who are on that development pathway can view NFTs and how that could help them.
I think they should view NFTs as a way to build their community. So let's say you're an artist and you have a small audience, but you would say maybe 50 people in that audience that I have, they seem very excited about me and very loyal, and I want to make sure that I reward them for supporting me, and I want to make sure to build that relationship with them. You could even, you could sell an NFT to them, but you could also give it to them for free. You don't have to sell it, and then you can attach perks to it further down the line or at the same time, just to make sure you give something back to them. And the great thing about it is that enables you to identify them. So currently, you're building, as an artist, you're building all of these audiences on the Instagrams, the TikToks, and whatever. But it's really, really hard to identify who your most engaged and your super fans are. But if you, let's say, would give them or sell to them NFTs, you would know these are the people that were there from the beginning, that were so excited about me that they bought an NFT from me, and you can keep chatting with them and keep making sure that they are there throughout your career. And I think that's a good way of seeing it, and just making sure you're not just, you know, growing your followers, but you're growing that relationship with them.
And it's a good way of proofing your audience as well, and just giving them something kind of new, even at a really kind of emerging level. So we worked with an Italian Congolese artist called Sanssouci, who's quite emerging from London, playing like Omira kind of level, but an amazing artist actually. And I just got talking to her quite early on in the Serenade journey, and we just did a small drop. It was only about 30 or 40 items, but they all sold really well, and you know, they were kind of reasonably priced. And that's something else that, if we've not mentioned so far, we should probably, in the sense that when we talk to artists of all levels, actually emerging and established, we talk about price points a lot. And again, trying to get away from this kind of like crypto bro culture of kind of high commercial outcomes, and just kind of talk about starting your journey in this space really kind of modestly. And actually, we talk about trying to put prices in line with pre-existing physical merch. So we'll say to them, you know, what do you charge for a hoodie, or what do you charge for a 7-inch or whatever, and kind of having it kind of in line. So it's just kind of part of kind of that offering. And she sold out, and she was really happy. And she had these just really beautiful bits of artwork that she'd done with a friend of hers attached to a song that hadn't been released, I think, although that wouldn't really been important. And for her, it was a real proofing of the fact that she had a core audience that that was supporting her and leaning in to this new idea that she had in this very new space. And that just, A, made her feel really good, and she had a new creative outlet, but also she's now got a relationship with those fans, because in the future, those, I forget how many there were, let's say 60 NFT buyers, are the beginning of this club, if you like, this community that she can in the future super serve. Yeah. So it's almost like the beginning of your fan club on steroids. You know, you can make sure that those fans are getting really good stuff that you can airdrop into their wallets whenever you want, as long as it's an open wallet. And that's then when you can get this kind of, you know, you can get like a notoriety about, oh, did you get one of those NFTs? Because I got one, and now I've got like a secret live stream, or I've got access to her Discord, or I've got access to whatever. So, and then the word gets out, and then those assets become scarce and desirable, and then there'll be pressure for her to release more, and, you know, large, you know, obviously, you know, bring more people in. So that there's a, it's kind of just working out what those early steps are and how you do it to start building that kind of, you know, really powerful fan club kind of, you know, tech, really.
That's really interesting, because yeah, like a lot of chat in the music world now is not about volume anymore. It's about concentration of super fans. It's about, like, if you've got 50 or 100 people who are really, really wanting to engage with you, you can build sustainable models on that. Let's talk a little bit about, you know, what the artists can decide, that the digital asset or the physical asset that, you know, an NFT token is, you know, facilitating. But there's been development in the area, certainly to my knowledge, of what the actual fan can hope to receive, and perhaps diversification. It was NAS that first brought it to my attention. I don't know whether lots of people had done it before him, but where it was like, you know, a share split, like, you know, you're going to, as a fan, if you buy my NFT, you're going to get a share of the royalties that I earn, and there's percentage breaks in that. Is that a reasonably new development, or have we seen people experiment in the past with that? And what's the thoughts on kind of, you know, the potentials are potentially endless, but is that an interesting aspect to you, and something you feel is sustainable for emerging artists to consider? Because then we get into rights, Chris, and we can maybe start you on that.
I mean, that's another product, isn't it? And
yeah.
I think it's we have these distinct different products, and almost, although they all have an NFT as part of the equation, we can treat each of those products separately. Mm. So I call that fan funding with a royalty right. Yeah. So you're releasing a track, you sell, you mint whatever, 100, 1,000 NFTs around the track. They all put some money in, and then they get access to the track. But the track's going to be on Spotify anyway. So I mean, the track is out there. But yes, part of the deal is that any money that this track makes, usually on the recording side, we will share some with you. Mm-hmm. Now, actually, that business model's not new, because in the mid-2000s, a whole load of startups tried to launch that. There was Slice the Pie, there was Celaban, there was Bandstocks, and they all failed. And then the next round of those sorts of platforms were not about giving artists a royalty right, a share of the money. It was about giving them perks. Mm-hmm. Okay, we're not going to give you any rights, we're not going to give you any money, but you'll get to feel like you have a special connection through the perks that we provide you. So it's interesting seeing these fan funding with royalty right platforms now come back, reinvented with NFTs as part of the equation. Mm-hmm. And I think that's an interesting question. It's like, okay, well, it didn't work in the mid-2000s. Why didn't it work? And actually, at the time, some people said, well, realistically, even if you're doing it with a relatively big artist, your royalty right is 0.00001% of any money. Mm-hmm. So unless it's a massive hit, the money you're going to get is negligible. And if it's a fan, okay, maybe with big name artists, it's actually sometimes investors who genuinely believe they can make some money. But if it's a fan, there was some research to the effect that actually fans don't want a royalty right. They're not in, they just want the warm glow of supporting the artist. So is it a whole load of admin to give artists, a small payment that they don't even want? Mm. All of that said, I mean, maybe with the NFT element, that it, you have the extra security that if the platform that I buy this NFT through goes under, because the data is stored on the blockchain rather than it being stored on a private database, I'm not reliant on that company still surviving to continue to get this royalty right. So I don't know whether or not that model that didn't work 20 years ago or 15 years ago is now going to work because of the NFT element. I have had some people say that maybe at the moment a lot of those platforms only have two or three artists at the time. So there's one startup called Opulous, which is founded by the same guys as Ditto, the distribution company. So obviously they can definitely handle the distribution and sorting out the royalties. That's what Ditto does. But to date, they've only ever had one NFT you can buy into at a time. And I know some people think, well, maybe if you had a platform where there was 1,000 artists all doing this at the same time, maybe for some people they could play A&R. And it sort of becomes a game. And I go in and I invest in 100 of those artists on the assumption that 99 of them will never see a penny, but one of them maybe becomes a hit, and then I am making a few hundred pounds a month or something. And so maybe, by, to use that horrible word, gamifying that, maybe there's an opportunity there. But I think of all of these things, it is actually really early days. And that's where the music-specific NFTs are really interesting, because almost you're just experimenting. It's like every time an artist comes along, it's like, well, let's try this. And maybe it works and maybe it doesn't work. But in doing so, so we learn. So my answer, that's a very long-winded way of saying, I don't really know whether that's a long-term opportunity.
Okay.
I think what's also quite interesting to see are the different approaches there. So a couple of days ago, I don't know who's seen this, but the Chainsmokers have announced that they are going to create, I think, I don't know exactly the amount, but I think 5,000 tokens for their most engaged, most loyal fans, and they will have rights embedded to all of the songs on their upcoming album. So they're not going to sell them. They just give them away for free based on people that have subscribed to their email list, like historic merch purchases and ticket purchases. So it just shows again how I think NFTs are really, we should see it more as a way of having that, rewarding the fans again, and who knows what they're going to do with those tokens in the future as well, but that whole fan club idea and rewarding people and creating that sort of club around that and giving something back to them. But also, it created this big story, so obviously, like, now it has, you know, it has this PR story that's going to promote the new album. All of these 5,000 fans have like an investment in kind of promoting the album to their fans as well. So they have their own street team that are going to promote the album for them. So it's a very kind of clever marketing strategy as well.
And just very quickly on the rights point, generally speaking with those propositions, no one is getting actual copyright. Okay, the copyright will stay with the artist and the label, the songwriter and the publisher. What they're getting is a royalty right. And I think there is an argument that that isn't always necessarily communicated very well, and it may be that there are some disputes in the future where people will say, I spent 10 grand, I thought I was now a copyright owner, and I am not a copyright owner, I'm on a 0.0001% royalty right. So I think there is some communications challenges there.
There was a deep dive done on Diplo's recent one I saw on Water and Music, and there it was basically they went through the terms and there wasn't a time frame agreed, there wasn't an ISRC mentioned, so there was a lot of kind of holes in that, and I think we're learning, so it's very early days, and as we go there will be points where we say, okay, right, this is the checklist of things that need to be done, but it's all around the terminology and the communication of it that's very hazy at the moment.
Yeah, totally. These are all reasons why it's not on our roadmap, because we just think it's fraught with all kinds of issues, from communication, from, I mean, you know, just as Chris was saying, like somebody going, so I'm not a copyright holder, so when Chainsmokers publishing or, you know, Master's catalogue gets sold, is there a fan somewhere expecting a percentage of that? Well, they're not going to get that because they've got a percentage of the streaming right as opposed to any copyright. So it's just how that's all communicated. But there's another couple of reasons, and everybody had kind of great points to this as well, is that I think the way that we see it is that At the top end, it's not a great investment unless you give it away like the Chainsmokers did, which was a really good idea and a really good story. So at the top end, I don't think it's a good enough investment for fans to really bother, to be honest. And at the bottom end, and this may be quite kind of, you know, idealistic of us, but I think that as digital merchandise or, you know, digital collectibles, which is what NFTs are, as they scale for artists and they become fresh, new, reliable revenue streams, I'd like to see that give artists the opportunity to remain independent for longer and not have to sell copyright to anybody, you know, their fans or Warner Chappell. You know, it's just this idea of kind of having a brand new sustainable revenue stream, which means that actually you don't need to fan fund your copyright because you're doing other cool bits of collectibles and you've got other stuff going on.
Yeah, that the Deep Blue one was really interesting, and I think it requires the buyer to have a nuanced understanding of the music industry, which, you know, it, nobody outside of the music industry, and even some just getting started in it, are trying to get under the hood of that. So yeah, I caught that one where people felt like it was an ownership, because sometimes things are being described, you know, in shares kind of terminology, like people are trying to make it sound simple to people and actually getting it wrong in the process or complicating it. So yeah, that one was an interesting one. And again, this is emerging. It's happening in real time right in front of us. Their mistakes are it's riddled in mistakes, and it can be. And I think that's probably one of the issues for the emerging artist community, where they're trying to build stable foundations, okay? And they're trying to build that connection with their fan and that ultimately trust. So that's why, you know, the potential hesitancy around NFTs is because of some of the headlines. And we talk about NFTs as a positive marketing potential, but the risk is that, you know, you just get it wrong. And it could be exactly the opposite. You know, it could be a PR disaster. So let's talk about, like, just some really good examples. I think it'd be really, really good to send people towards examples of, you know, creatively or even technically, what makes a good NFT? What are the thought processes that any fan should kind, or any artist who's considering this in their portfolio, what should they be thinking? Tangible examples, if possible. Of tangible, in the context.
I think that it's important that from a creative side, it needs to be relevant to the artist. It needs to tie in with a story or a narrative. It has to either have some kind of personal connection or a way of kind of making it feel like a natural progression. Mm-hmm. So a fan isn't just kind of like, oh, this is just another money stunt. This means something. So yeah, that could be that it fits in with an album pre-order, for example, and then you can kind of make your NFT something around the story of writing the album. You've got kind of the opportunity for catalog. You can go into an archive and then produce an archive collection for an NFT. So it's really in the creative side, making it make sense.
Okay. And actually, just before I send it down this way for further answers on that same point, again, let's talk a little bit about the potential for the physical, like actual physical product, as well as just the digital collectible aspect of it. So go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, an NFT doesn't have to be only connected to digital goods. It can also be connected to physical goods. And I think probably the most exciting ones probably have something of both in there.
I mean, an example is that there are Shopify plugins where if you have an NFT in your wallet, it will unlock areas of a Shopify store that mean that you get exclusive access to specific merchandise. So there's a way that it translates from something that's in your wallet to something you receive in the post.
Okay.
And yeah, the physical thing doesn't have to be specifically, for example, a vinyl. It could also be that someone is buying an NFT and it has like a digital art, but then you attach perks to it, like, and they can show it at a live show, for example, and they would get, I don't know, like a discount for merch or a meet and greet or whatever. So just experiences in the real world as well.
Yeah, because Coachella is probably a good example of that. Like, they've launched their festival tickets as an NFT. And that includes the Coachella ticket, of course, which anyone could buy without an NFT. But the physical benefit of, you know, having the NFT is that you get added bonuses, and sometimes mysterious added bonuses. You don't know what the added bonus is. You got to wait and see. I guess it's just, yeah, I think confidence will grow in this area the more that it's, more that artists see people they trust in the artist space doing it. And obviously there are lots of really majorly successful artists using the space, but that when you're majorly successful and you've a massive captive audience, you can play with that a little bit. When you're an independent artist developing, you gotta be cautious.
You go first.
So I was going to do just a really quick thing to what Jen said, which I don't think can be stressed enough, which is certainly to an emerging artist, and you know what, any artist actually, but especially to an emerging artist, when they're entering this world for the first time, some of them, and we've seen it not with us but on other platforms, where they feel they need to enter it in a bit of a crypto way and then kind of become something they're not. And maybe, and you know, there are examples of hooking up with a kind of quite kind of NFT or crypto or digitally native visual artist, and then they collab and that can go really well. You know, and we did that with the Brit Awards. We did the Brit Awards first ever NFT drop, and we collaborated with an amazing 3D designer who did these kind of iterations of the statuette, and they sold really well, and that was great. But I think for an artist, they shouldn't feel that they have to do that. Mm. They can just be themselves, and as long as, just as Jen was saying, they've got an authentic story to tell and they're not trying to kind of bend into the space too much to kind of distort or morph who they are, I think that's the only way that it can be done. And you know, we say that because it's amazing how many times we have to talk artists out of trying to be something they're not when they put this new kind of world in front of them, you know.
I would like to give two examples of independent artists and how they approached it, and maybe what I would think is a good approach and maybe where you could work on. So I was consulting for this independent artist, and it was his first release, so he didn't have an audience yet. And I think because of all of the headlines, he kind of felt like, okay, I feel like I need to do an NFT because it seems like that's what people are doing at the moment. And he probably read all of these headlines of it makes a lot of money. So he kind of just created, I think, like 50 different photos and wanted to sell them as NFTs and was like hoping that someone with a lot of crypto would buy it. And I was like, I don't think that's going to happen. I was like, you don't have an audience yet. There's no really, like, you know, these are nice pictures, but like, what's the value there? And I kind of said to him, like, really think about, obviously you don't have your audience yet, but maybe wait a bit until you've built that and then find out what they would like to see from you and then package that up as an NFT. And then I read about an independent artist where that was sort of the headline, an independent artist made $20,000 or something with a collection of NFTs. And I think he just approached it really from a way of creating an exciting story around it and also really trying to promote it, because you can't just like put it out there and think someone's going to buy it. You really, I guess, have to then also think about how are you going to promote it to the people and make them excited about it and wanting them to invest in it. And he created, like, he also hadn't released music before. He started a crowdfunding campaign and then said, okay, I want to get to this goal, to produce my first album. And in order to get there, I'm going to sell 3 different NFT backstage passes, 3 different tiers. The first one is going to give you access to this membership platform, probably Discord, which is kind of a thing that a lot of NFTs do, like giving you access to this exclusive Discord, for example, where you can chat with other people that are invested in the artist. And then the second tier would give you like exclusive merch. And then the third tier would give you like lifetime access to future shows. And you would also have like a say in a label that he's going to set up in the future. Obviously, that was also like a big gamble because people would never know if he's going to become successful or if his label is going to become successful. But I think at least he was kind of like really giving them this vision of if you like me now and you support me now, these are the, you know, this is what we can do together. Mm. I thought that was kind of like structured in a really nice way.
Yeah, it's a great example. And Chris?
And I would say actually that it seems to me the challenge is not a technology challenge, because platforms like, you know, the platforms which are music specific are dealing with the technology problems. You know, which blockchain do you use? How do you get the cost of minting an NFT down? Obviously, all the environmental considerations as well. But, you know, the music specific NFT platforms, they're dealing with all of that. You don't have to worry about that. The question is, it's a creative challenge, isn't it? And I do see, I've always split up an artist's revenues. How do artists make money? Well, they make content and copyright and they monetize that over here. And they do live shows and they monetize live forms over here. And then you have a fan relationship and you super serve your super fans to make more money out of the fan relationship. And I put NFTs very much in the latter camp. Yes, some content might be involved. Yes, a show might be involved. But ultimately, it's about the fan relationship. And that's your point, that there's no point. If you don't have a fan base, this ain't going to work for you.
Yeah.
Okay, you've got to have an engaged fan, not a massive engaged fan base, but you've got to have an engaged fan base. And then the creative challenge is, well, what will excite these fans? And I think that's always been the challenge with the direct-to-fan side of the business, is there is no template you can take off the shelf. Because the question is, what will get your fans excited? And then I think almost with Director Fan, you're almost selling emotional things, aren't you? So sometimes it's community spirit, which is this idea, you become part of my team, we're gonna have a label, we're gonna sign artists together, so we're gonna be part of a community. And for some people, that's really attractive. Then there's supporter satisfaction, and that's the Patreon model, really, isn't it? I mean, often, you know, people will be buying NFTs with some artists, not because they actually even want the collectible, but because they get the warm glow of supporting an artist they really love. And then the final one, which certainly at the higher end, is what I call bragging rights. And at the end of the day, you know, when you used to buy a band T-shirt and wear it to school or college, was it because it was a really good T-shirt, or were you bragging to everyone else, I'm the real fan of this artist because, look, I've got the T-shirt. And when you bought the £500 box set, was it because actually the content was better, or was it because I'm a real fan, look, I've got the £500 box set? So actually, it was always about bragging rights, and I think that's what the NFT allows you to do. I'm a real fan of this artist. And look, this little bit of data on the blockchain confirms it to anybody who wants to, you know, challenge me on that. So as I say, I think the challenge is creative. Who are your fans, your core fan base, what gets them excited, and of all these NFT projects we talked about today, what will be relevant to them? So it's not really a technology thing, it's a creative thing.
Yeah.
And I think, sorry, just to bring it back to the generational point from earlier on, and I really smile when I hear Chris talking about, you know, vinyl and box sets and all the rest of it, because I often think about my 10-year-old daughter in, like, probably even a year or two from now, not long, is she's going to say to me, why did you get all your friends around on a Saturday night to show them your vinyl and get them drunk? Because also she'll say, well, why are you drinking? Because that's really bad for you, because she'll be that generation, right? But she'll just think it's really weird that I went through the inconvenience of inviting people from around the region or the city or the country to my house to show them these dusty old bits of plastic, to, you know, for me to remind them that I'm, you know, into this, and this is who I am, and this is my taste, and this is the art I surround myself with. Because she'll be like, I've got a black pink digital collectible on my phone, or it'll be called something else by that point. And I know that can be seen by all black pink fans around the world, and I know that all my friends can see it, and that's really convenient. She'll just think that's like a really obvious way of showing her taste. And she'll also say to me, that piece of Led Zeppelin vinyl that you tell me is rare, I don't know it's rare, it's just you telling me it's rare. But the blockchain tells me that only 10 of these were made, so I know it's rare. So you're a loser.
Yeah, this is the I think the most important point in all of this. It's as a music fan myself, I love the idea of investing in an artist's success, be that you buy the CD, you buy the T-shirt, whatever. Like, in my friendship circle, I really value my position as the person that will be the person that switches my friends on to the artist they should know about tomorrow. I really value that position I play in it. But now there is the opportunity to prove it and not just say, yeah, it was me that told you about, you know, Christine and the Queens years and years and years ago, because I was listening to Amazing Radio and you weren't. You know, it was Radio 1 before you became aware of that artist, and that was a few steps down the line. So, like, I see the essence of that has always been there. It's always been really, really important, and this is the manifestation of it now. Let's get on to the services for a moment, okay? Because, again, like, you know, we talk about the creative ideas. Like, where do you go? How do you actually begin the process of, you've got this great idea, you've sounded out, you feel it's really authentic, it can work for you, and you want to actually then deliver that to your artist. You're an artist, you want to deliver it to your fans. What are the services? And let's just kind of, like, put a few out so that people can go away and have a look.
I mean, there are definitely a couple of more music-specific platforms such as Cirkay, Serenade, popping up. And I think that's quite important, because I think these services, they are really, you know, have in mind to make it as easy for the fan as possible. And at Music Ally internally, we've been, like, testing out different platforms, you know, trying to understand how they all work. And it's really, really apparent how all of these NFT platforms that are, you know, general, where there's loads of different art on there, they're just overwhelming, and they are really, really hard to understand. And I was on there and I was just like, I'm doing this every single day, and even I find it confusing. No, like, it's not, music fans, the average music fan will not do that. So it's really nice to see platforms that are trying to rely less on crypto, so making it possible to buy with credit card, making music-specific ones where also the fans can trust and they know they go there specifically to collect something that's related to music rather than, you know, all of this other stuff that's out there. So I guess just to name drop a few besides the ones that we've already talked about, there's one-off as well. And also very interesting, I think, is to see that there are many platforms, NFT platforms, that are more specific for music, that are really trying to bring the environmentally friendly aspect to it, built on different blockchains that are more environmentally friendly. Then what else is there?
Sound is pretty interesting.
Sound, yeah.
So. Yeah, for emerging artists, sound focuses on kind of being the person that was like, well, I knew about them first. And you can literally write a comment onto the NFT that is saved to go, you know, this is my thoughts on it, and I was here first kind of thing. So, yeah, sound's definitely one that's...
They tend to be kind of more Web3 savvy artists, don't they? Kind of artists that are already in that kind of world. So artists that you wouldn't necessarily know about because they're not kind of exposed kind of greatly elsewhere, but they have a community around them in that space, and actually they can do quite well on sound, can't they? So they can sell songs for 250 books, I think it is.
Yeah, I was looking on there yesterday, and I know she's not emerging, but she's definitely within the DIY scene. Kate Nash released... And within 24 hours, she'd sold 25 NFTs, raised 2.5 ETH, which is about $5,000. And so, yeah, there's real potential there. And every artist on there, you can see how much they've made, and it's converted into fiat currency. So,
is there an A&R process on those? Just whenever you talk about sound specifically, like you AWOL, for example, or Spin Up or whatever, you know, you want to get on there, you put yourself forward for it, and there's an A&R process almost in the middle. Is it similar with sound?
Sound is curated, I believe, yeah. And actually, I also believe that if you don't sell out your collection, you don't get invited back. I think.
Yeah, I'm not quite sure on the details there, but yeah.
Okay, cool. Something worth
checking. I mean, we're getting several press releases a day around music NFT projects. Now, some of those are labels and management announcing their projects, but quite a lot of them are new platforms launching.
Okay.
We sort of got overwhelmed and ignored them. I know your colleague Stuart is trying to document every single one. So on the Music Ally site, even though I'm promoting a competitor here, but I know Stuart's really following every single one. And same thing, the press releases arrive, and if we're being honest, it's a load of nonsense, the press release. And so it's going through and saying, okay, well, what are you doing? And so it is tricky because there's lots of platforms out there, and some are skewing more towards superstars, some are skewing more to DIY talent, some are curated, some anybody can do it. And I think there is that fear that you might invest some time working with a platform, getting some traction, and then... Because all these platforms cannot survive.
Yeah.
So it's hard to know. Although I suppose in theory, the NFT element means you're not platform dependent. Mm-hmm. So in theory, if you go over a platform and it all falls down, providing the NFTs are logged on a recognizable blockchain, generally Ethereum, then you can outlive the platform.
So that's the key checkpoint for anyone getting on it. Make sure that the blockchain technology they're using is... recognized, bona fide, that can be a really important checkpoint. Yeah?
Yeah, I would say so.
Okay,
I would say
cool.
So, yeah, definitely. And I do think it will be a bit different to streaming, where there's just obviously two, three big winners. I do think the NFT space will be a little bit more diverse.
Okay.
And I think it will be diverse in the way that the blockchain ecosystem will remain diverse. And somebody told me this great analogy recently about think of blockchains as different cities. So you've got Ethereum, which is like London, which is like the big, you know, like the big piece of architecture. And you've got, you know, like layer twos that are like estates and tower blocks within that, where they've had to build up as opposed to out. And then you've got, you know, links to other cities, which are like bridges, which can be... So each blockchain's got its own culture and its own pros and cons, and I found that really interesting, and I think that really helped me kind of visualize how there will be multiple blockchains in the future for different use cases, and actually music will live across many different blockchains.
Yeah. Okay. And just go
ahead. Sorry, quickly add, in terms of if you're making NFTs actually with music. Mm. So, I mean, lots of the music NFTs, actually, there's no music in the product. But if you're actually using music, so it's a track or it's a video that contains a track, that's where we do get into the rights complications. Okay. And I think working with a platform that's clearly has music industry people advising them or on their team, so that, for example, if you didn't write the song, or if there's co-writers on the song, or even if you wrote the song and you're a PRS member, technically you don't control all the rights as a PRS member. Yeah. So I think the music-specific NFT platforms, or the good ones, mm-hmm. are learning to navigate those rights questions, whereas a generic NFT platform won't even think about that. Yeah. It's just like, let's just get some content on and we'll deal with that later. So that's where I, you know, the music specific platforms is
let's
where
name check them,
I
Chris. Can you name check a few okay, of them? Just well, so people have, yeah. Do you want to do it, Mike? Well, just so people have it, they can go and make their own decisions afterwards, but it's just to make this world a little bit smaller.
Well, the ones on this panel, obviously. Yeah. And I know, now you're going to put me on the spot. I'm trying to remember the names of other ones we've already mentioned.
That's okay.
I mean, obviously, LimeWire is launching. We're still figuring out what they're going to do. So an NFT startup that bought the LimeWire brand, and they're courting the majors. Mm. And then the Napster streaming service is adding NFT functionality to it. But again, those are both relatively recent announcements, and I don't think we've really figured out what they're going to do.
Yeah, then there's also one called Curio, which I think also saw investment from Universal and Maker's Place, saw investment from Sony, which I always like. It's at least because like a lot of the major label artists as well haven't really, besides some of the big ones last year, haven't really done much because I think they're still kind of figuring out what the right situation is. So I see that if they invest in a platform, at least it kind of feels like they've done their due diligence and like these seem to be good platforms to work with. Yeah. Obviously, there's Royal, where you can sell a share of your royalties.
Opulous is the other one in that space.
Okay. Shall we do some Q&A? Will you throw it open? Does anyone have questions? Yes, of course. Go ahead.
What about making money on NFTs? Is it when you sell NFTs as an artist or a record company or whatever, and you sell it to me, and I resell it, and they resell it,
well, that depends on the NFT, but that is one thing that a lot of people talk about is having, yes, that the original seller and creator of the NFT, you can, through a smart contract in the NFT, put a resale condition in, which means that I would get a cut of any resale.
I mean, that's standard with us. So every NFT we produce, every digital collectible has a smart contract in it, and which is why we often say to artists that it's just digital merchandise in which you forever get a royalty, and that means that, and our commercials are that the artist gets 85% of the first sale, we get 15%, but then on every single sale in perpetuity, the original creator, the artist or their team gets 15% and gets 15% of every single sale of the gross at time of sale. So we often say to artists, going back to the pricing conversation earlier on, we often say, you know, try and start your journey quite modestly because if we all get our job right and we get the pricing and the scarcity right and these assets sell out really quickly and therefore have a secondary market value, the 15% that you get on every single sale in perpetuity will end up being a lot more than the 85% you got of the primary sale. So that's a pricing conversation we have with artists all the time. Think about the long game and think about pricing and getting the asset right so it sells out really quickly.
Does that answer your question? Yeah. Another question? Yeah. Go for it, we'll try.
So the first one, when you were speaking about particularly royalty rights, if you're giving away portions of the master's rights, is there a way within your contracts that you can envisage that artists would be able to say, well, I'm giving you this royalty right, however small, however the clearances that I might need, for example, like the one-stop shop sync, I still control that?
Totally. I mean, I can't imagine any part of that is an actual right to control exploitation.
But crucially, this depends what you put in the token. So that you can put anything in the token. But as I say, as far as I'm aware, pretty much every drop, which is a royalty right thing, it is very much a royalty right. And actually, it's a streaming royalty right. So not only would you not be able to get involved in doing a sync deal, you also wouldn't earn from a sync deal. But crucially, as a buyer, you have to read the terms and conditions. I mean, unless you don't care. But if you are actually buying thinking that you're going to get some rights or some money, then you need to read the terms and conditions because literally every token could be different. And as a seller, I mean, that's a really good point. Even if you were selling copyright, which I don't think anyone would advise that you should, but even if you were, that's something you need to consider about. Because if you sell 0.1% of the copyright, that means that person now has a veto on any sync deal that you do. So therefore, you would need to be, you get 0.1% of the copyright, but with no veto over sync. But that would have to go in the contract.
Can I also ask, I've heard, looking into this space quite a lot, I've heard blockchain cryptos being described as environmentally friendly. And I get a little bit worried that this is the same way as like, you know, in the fishing industry, you say like, oh, this is eco-friendly.
That's a very good question. That I know you guys have been doing a lot on that space, but I know the indie labels that we've been talking to, it's great that there are startups out there talking up their environmental credentials, but how do we know that that's genuine and it's not just a PR line?
Yeah, that's a really good question. So this is something that we take super seriously at Serenade. This is like, you know, it's probably like the beginning of most conversations we have with artists, and we put it at the beginning of the conversation because it's something we take so seriously. So some platforms, not us, do have an offsetting kind of model where they'll plant some trees or whatever it is, which I think is a little bit opaque, if I'm honest. So all we do is we work with academics in the space who spend all day, every day looking at the energy efficiency of blockchains, and we work with the best energy efficient blockchains that we can find. So at the moment we work with Polygon, and Polygon are what they call a layer two of Ethereum, which means that you get all of the liquidity and security and immutability of the larger Ethereum ecosystem, but you get to create your assets in a way more energy efficient way. So in some cases, 44,000 times more efficient. So our academics tell us that we're okay to say to artists, minting an NFT with us is the same carbon footprint as 1/10 of a tweet. And you would have to mint 197,000 NFTs with us in order to get to the same carbon footprint as one 12-inch vinyl. So really, really puts it into perspective. The other good news about the energy efficiency in the space, and also don't get me wrong, I'd never want to dismiss this topic because, you know, the way Bitcoin is made is actually massively energy inefficient because it's a duplication of process where they have all these computers. It's called proof of work, where they're just trying to outdo each other on a math equation, and it's a ridiculous amount of energy use for one coin, right? So that's the old way of minting things on chain. The new way is proof of stake, and the whole of Ethereum, which is currently proof of work, is allegedly moving to proof of stake in the next few months. ETH 2.0 will hopefully, pardon the pun, change the temperature of some of the conversations around this space in general, because I think everybody, including the people that run that massive bit of architecture, realized that in order to get social traction, it needs to be done properly.
But interesting, when the NFTs connect with the metaverse and the virtual worlds, it's interesting when you see the companies building the metaverse platforms, they predominantly do talk about carbon offsetting. And I think that's because at the moment they're in the you know, running a virtual world is a whole, you know, new ballgame when it comes to energy consumption. So, you know, the Facebooks and the Googles of this world, they're talking a lot about having the super, you know, first of all, data centers which are completely powered by renewables, and then secondly, yeah, the carbon offsetting as well. So I think there is a lot of the conversation has been around the environmental impact of the NFT element, but I think as it increasingly shifts over to metaverse, there's a whole new environmental conversation.
That's a great question. Thank you for that. And that's where we're going to leave it today. I seen there was a few other hands. Maybe you can just have a chat with us at the end. Okay. So thank you so much for being here. Thank you so much to my panel for their honesty. And I hope that helped.